First, thank you all for having me here in this beautiful city, and thank you for organizing it, of course. I will do it in English. My Italian is not so good. I only know some words that they yell during football matches, so that's not appropriate. And thank you, Paola, and all the others. But Paola, I connect to your work because my research project that I'm been carrying out for 4 years was on the practices of museum guides, and there are different words for them: facilitators, interpreters, educators. Well, we can go on, but we call them museum guides. And I worked together with the Rijksmuseum of Amsterdam, Van Gogh Museum, and the Stedelijk, which is a modern art museum. And together, over the last 4 years, we studied which competencies museum guides should have, what are the possible learning outcomes of a guided tour, and how we can help them to professionalize. And it was more or less in the context of guided tours for school groups, although I think that the competencies we created are also applicable to guides who give tours to adults. So first, to start with the end, well, actually, it's not as big as on the screen, but this is the book that we created, which is a result of the four-year PhD project. It's not my dissertation yet. It's these are the practical insights of the research. So I also write scientific articles, but we also created this book because we think it's important to give educators and museum guides, well, tools to work with. And the most important thing I think we created is a profile of competencies that can serve as a common language for educators and museum guides. So we created a profile for them to discuss about the profession. And this profile is in the book, but you can also download it for free online. So I will give the link for everyone who is interested. But this was presented last week during the Museum Guides Now Symposium in Amsterdam that we organized with the three museums. And well, I work for the university, but I'm very happy to work with these museums because someone said it already before today that it's important for universities to really go into the museum and to collaborate, because if you do it only in your ivory tower at the university, then it won't work, then you won't reach the people that you want to reach. So first, I will guide you a little bit through the competencies that we created. We have four main areas of competence. And the first one is really related also to what Sahava said yesterday about the entrance narrative. Because as a museum guide, it's very important to know who the group is that is visiting the museum. So it's very important that in the first few minutes, you really connect with the group. So you get to know the entrance narrative of each visitor. That makes it possible for you to make connections between the visitor and the objects, and to help them to find their own meaning in the objects. For example, if you have a group of people in the museum who already know a lot about a piece of art, then it's not really necessary to tell them about this during the tour. Then you can have a conversation about it, which is probably more interesting. And it's also very important, especially for students or for pupils who visit the museum, to create a safe learning environment. Because for children, it can be very exciting to go to the museum. It's sort of an environment they don't often visit. So it's important to make sure that they feel welcome and that they are willing to participate, that they feel that they can ask you a question or tell you a story. And furthermore, it's also very important to be enthusiastic, of course. Well, you said that it sometimes can be difficult to keep your enthusiasm also because, well, the wages are not too high. Often people who work in the museum as a guide are volunteers. At least in the Netherlands, I think 70% is a volunteer. The museums we work with have freelancers. They are paid to give tours, but they are not under a contract. So they have to work in different museums. One of the museum guides that I interviewed works in 10 museums. So you have to go from one place to another and to another, which is very tiring, of course. It's also very nice to work in different museums, but It's also difficult. But she said, I'm not a guide, to come back to the discussion, I'm a facilitator. I'm facilitating the conversations. And of course, I have the knowledge. So if people ask me the question, I can give them an answer. But I really want to engage in a conversation and talk with children about art and history. So if you are more a facilitator, I think it's more easy to work in different museums if you are less knowledge focused. But still, you need the knowledge, of course. And in order to communicate with the people, of course, you need communication skills. And that's not only talking skills or conversation techniques, but maybe more important even is listening skills. So listen to what the group is saying and use the answers they give to have an even more fruitful conversation with them. And in this, the non-verbal, my non-verbal communication is a bit hidden behind the desk, but it's also very important to use non-verbal communication, of course. For example, if you want the group to come closer, then you should do this and not come come closer, because then probably they won't come to you. And the third category we created is knowledge and pedagogy. So of course you need the knowledge. You need the knowledge to tell stories, to ask the right questions, to answer questions. But most importantly, it's important to be flexible with your knowledge. So every group needs a different amount of knowledge that you give them. So you should really adjust your tour to the group that is standing in front of you. And the key word we found, and I think I performed over 40 interviews in the total project, and if I would do a word count in all the interviews, the word that was used most was flexibility. Because, well, what I said, every group is different, so you need to be flexible. And not only because of that, but also the museum environment is very different than a classroom environment. Then you have just one room, one group, but in the museum there are other visitors, so they can be standing in front of an object that you want to discuss. Then you have to make a decision, will I go there or will I go to another piece of art? So flexibility is the key. And the last category is professionalism. Well, in this, one of the key competencies, especially the educators and the heads of education mentioned, was that as a guide, you are an ambassador to the museum. You have to represent the museum and have to make sure that the people that are coming feel welcome. But furthermore, in this category, you have like skills to reflect on your own practices and eagerness to professional develop yourself. Well, we also did one intervention in the museum. We created a self-evaluation tool for museum guides and an observation tool for educators, because in the Netherlands, often the professional activities that are organized by the museums are post-observation conversations or feedback conversations. So you have an educator who works at the museum, and the educator will observe a tour of the tour guide or the museum guide, and then afterwards they engage in a feedback conversation. And normally these conversations are mainly directed by the observations of the educator. But because we think it's important to also reflect on your own practices, we ask the guides to fill in a self-evaluation and to use that as the starting point of the conversation. Because, and they said afterwards that this gives them more agency. And I think that's very important, because insights that you gain from self-reflection are often more valuable than when some supervisor says to you, oh, you did this good and this wrong. So if you come to these insights on your own, they are more eager to change your behavior. And besides that, because we gave them these tools, they also had sort of a common language to discuss about the profession. So overall, and these tools can be downloaded as well online for free. So overall, the museum educators as well as the museum guys were quite happy to use these tools, because they felt the conversation was a little bit more equal. And the goal is, of course, to help a museum guide in their self-development. And, well, this was more helpful to them than only listen to the observations of the educator. Then, well, this is an example. You can't really see it, I think, not that good, but so this is an overview of the results. What was also the case, normally the observations in the museum by an educator are a one-time observation. In our case, we asked them to observe two tours and to use the self-evaluation, which also gave them more and a bigger impression of the overall performance, because you can imagine if you are being observed that you are a bit anxious, and if you do something wrong, maybe normally you don't do that wrong, and maybe normally you are a better guide. So if you have more opportunities to show what you can do, then someone gets a more overall view of your performance. So like I said, I will give some examples of what these museums do for professional development. Well, the most used method to help the guides to professionalize is just to ask them to shadow each other, so to follow each other and to observe the practices of other guides. So for example, if you know that this guide is very good in starting a conversation with children, then you might go and observe this guide and see how he or she is doing this. And currently the Rijksmuseum is using the self-evaluation, and they ask the guides to fill it in and then engage in a conversation together. So there's not an educator, but there are peers, guides and guides that have a conversation together. They also use video recordings of the guides, which is not always easy, of course, also because of, in the Netherlands at least, the rights. If you have children in the guided tour, then you have to ask permission to make a recording. But video recordings, of course, are very useful to get insights in your own practices. Other things, they give trainings and workshops on specific things, for example, to have an open conversation about difficult topics, political topics. Non-verbal communication trainings, but also training to create a connecting thread in a tour, which is important for these museums because you go from one object to another, but they think it's, well, and I also think that it's important to make connections between objects to tell sort of a bigger story through the in your tour. And what we also did in our study is to have a professional learning community. We had three museum guides who collaborated with student teachers in art and history. And together, they looked into a tour program and tried to find points for improvement. And the main thing that was interesting for them was to have a discussion about the profession. So the museum guides were really asked to explain what they do and why they do it, and to engage in a conversation with student teachers and also other guides, and that really helped them to think about their profession. So even if you organize a session with your guides to have a conversation about what everybody is doing and to talk about best practices or points for improvement, that I think is very helpful already. Well, this is sort of the end of the project that I'm doing. There is some sort of side project that I will engage in the next couple of months, in which we really investigate what the learning outcomes of a program of the Rijksmuseum is. And hopefully, because the museums were also very enthusiastic to do the research, so hopefully we can continue with doing research and collaborate, because, well, I really would encourage everybody to do like this collaborations with museums and universities and to use the insights you both have, because for us it was really, really interesting for me as a researcher to go into the field, which makes me enthusiastic also to work in a museum now, because I'm also a historian, so very passionate about that. But I would really encourage you to do that as well. And if you have any questions, you can always come to me and ask me a question. I can give you a card, so you can always send me an email and I can send you the links to all the things that you want. Also important to say is we created this profile and it's for art and history museums, but if your museum, if you look at the 45 competencies and you think this is important for us but these four competencies not, just skip them and make your own selection. So these tools are free to use in a way that you want them to use. So thank you.